QI, where this day we sally forth upon a quest with our knights quadruple. All hail the valiant and mighty Sir Philip the Jupitus. The gallant and audacious Sir Alan de Carr. The puissant and fearless Lady Alice Levine. And the knight on the tiles, Alan Davis. List ye to their nightly noises. Sir Philip the Jupitus goes... Sir Alan de Carr goes... Lady Alice Levine goes... and Alan goes... Right, draw your swords and prepare for combat.
I can't actually move with this one.
It looks nice on you, weirdly.
Probably weirdly. Oh,
sorry. Halfway through the show, he's going to go, oh, I feel drained.
Phil looks like he's got a wind machine on him.
No,
I... Yes! I saw a Labrador with its head out the car window.
Oh, looking. Nice. You can take them off, darling.
Well, how do they wear glasses in the olden days?
They hadn't invented glasses in the olden days, darling.
You see, I'm going to struggle on this show.
Phil, if you want to...
Oh, sorry, I was given to understand there was a beekeeping round.
I can't tell if you're coming or going.
Hello, I'm from Amsterdam. Would you like some lovely cheese?
Shall we start the show and do a question? So, what's this man's name?
Hmm? Is it Don Quixote?
Yes, darling.
Don Quixote.
X is a ch sound, isn't it?
Well, the X is a sh, technically, because he's speaking Old Castilian in the book, and it should be Don Quixote.
Quixote.
But I think we could say Quixote, don't you, Dave?
Well, is Don short for something, like Donald or Donna?
No, it was more of an honorary title.
Like the Don.
Yeah, like the Don, yeah. Oh, right. But Quixote, that sounds like an Irish order, doesn't it? I love Quixote.
Quixote.
Actually, technically, he's not called any of those things because the protagonist in the book is called Alonso Quiano. So Don Quixote is a name he makes up for himself when he loses his marbles and assumes the character of a medieval knight. Lots of people argue it is the world's first modern novel.
Where do they argue?
In the literary world, my darling.
Oh!
He wrote it in prison, actually, which seems to be a good place to write a book. And it was an immediate and roaring success. So the question is, why might Elizabeth I not have read it?
She could read, couldn't she?
Do you know what she could read in six languages?
Does she like beach reads, like the kind of big paperback?
Danielle Steele.
Yeah, exactly.
What's the one thing that we know about Elizabeth I?
Anything? Didn't she lose all her teeth?
Yes, that wasn't the thing I was looking for, but yes, that is...
Because I based my act on her.
What is a big event in history that Elizabeth I...
To do with the Spanish, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, yes.
The Armada.
Spanish Armada, absolutely.
So she wasn't reading a lot of Spanish
Cervantes was a buying agent for the Spanish Armada.
Very good pronunciation of Cervantes.
Cervantes.
Cervantes. I can say that.
Yeah. Two beers. Yeah. That's all my Spanish as well. But actually, that thing that you were doing, That is a little bit like Elizabeth I when she'd lost all her teeth, apparently. Foreign ambassadors couldn't understand her. And obviously, because she was queen, she carried on chatting.
If she's anything like my nan, I'll tell you what Queen Elizabeth I was saying. Go and get a 20 senior service.
In the novel itself, Don Quixote goes mad because of reading. It used to be believed that reading, or what they called excessive contemplation, was incredibly bad for you, and it caused the most astonishing range of illnesses. So if you read too much, you could get all of these things, according to Dr. Robert Burton. Gout, catarrhs, wasting, indigestion, colic, crudities, vertigo, consumption and wind. All caused by reading too much.
It's like the menu in a gastro pub.
I feel like I'm in an exciting new hipster coffee bar. Oh, I'll have the colic, please.
The top 10 names
two
in
shots.
England in 2035. Oh, yeah, so gout and wasting are at camp, but colic's at home.
Can I just say, though, it's so nice to be with another Alan, because Alan, they're like the white rhino, they're going extinct. There's only me, you and Alan Titchmarsh going. Did you know that? There's no other Alan. You think with me being on the telly, there'd be a few more, but sadly not.
I love you very much, Alan, but I think you being on television is not going to encourage the breeding of children. I'm just...
Backstage went, Alan, I know it's your first time on. I'll be very kind and very lovely. I'll be back in the playground. Don't you stamp on me glasses while you're at it.
Collective for Alan's is. I wonder what the...
Pride.
A pride. You happy with that, Danny?
Yeah.
OK, fantastic. I'm pleased. Cervantes himself had quite an adventurous life. He was in the Spanish army, during which he got shot 3 times.
Well, he's got a sword in him there.
Well, yes, that's not the
thing. Oh, I keep writing. Don't worry.
He lost the use of his left arm. He was kidnapped and held captive as a slave for 5 years. He was arrested 3 times. He was excommunicated 3 times. I mean, he really had the most astonishing life.
Is he from Albert Square? That's a sort of CV in EastEnders, all of those bad things happen to you.
Nasty Nick, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now, his death date is recorded as the 23rd of April, 1616. It is the same date as Shakespeare, and yet they died 10 days apart. How is that possible?
You're lying.
Yes. Correct. 10 points. No. 23rd of April, we celebrate St George's Day and Shakespeare's birthday. 1616. Right. So yeah. Shakespeare famously died on his birthday. So the same day they are marked down as dying, and yet they died 10 days apart. How is that possible?
Is it that calendar they
use?
Is it Julian calendar?
Yes, darling.
Which is also my drag name.
Really?
Yes! Oh, my God!
Entirely right. So, Europe was using the Gregorian calendar and England was still using the Julian calendar. Oh. And so the dates are very slightly apart. Also, in Spain, the date of death was recorded as the day you were buried rather than the day you actually died. Now, what's the most thankless job in history?
Was being a mum, surely.
Yeah. Don't try and get the mum vote.
We have to say thank you to mum in our house. We won't get any biscuits.
What's the worst job you ever had, Alan?
I put the raisins into fruit and fibre.
Did you? Yeah. Did somebody else do the apple bits? You were only in charge of the raisins.
Yeah. They came in a big box, I tipped it. I didn't put them in individually.
Oh, wish I'd gone to school.
Anybody else? Terrible job?
I was once working at a record company and someone had a record out with a lyric in it that mentioned Mr. Potato Head. And so I was asked, as a promotional device, to carve faces into 100 potatoes.
OK, most thankless job in history comes from ancient China, so we're going to go back to 400 to 100 BC, and there were people called Yusha, and they were on a constant quest to rescue anybody in trouble and to help the poor. But they hated being thanked because they were too modest. In fact, it was part of their fundamental beliefs that you should never receive praise. So they are almost the equivalent of the knight errants, which is what Don Quixote was.
But were they really modest, or were they like, no, please don't.
No, they had codes of chivalry. So there was one called Chuchia, and he saved hundreds of people's lives, but whenever anybody thanked him, he couldn't bear it. Even when he saved a king's life, he refused to ever see him again just in case he was thanked. It was absolutely part of who they were. There's a period of time in China, it's the 250-year period of warring states, and lots of dynasties were fighting for control. In the end, the dynasty called Qin finally won, that's Q-I-N, and that is where China gets its name from the Qin dynasty. So you can see this area down here on the left. That only lasted for about 15 years. But in these times of untrustworthy government, instability, people turned to these more self-sacrificing Yusha knights to dispense justice instead. Actually, the Chinese made a TV series called Yusha, and it was based on an American television series. Can anybody imagine what it might have been?
Starsky and Hutch.
Well, you've got it in that the car is critical.
Oh, Car 54, where are you?
Knight Rider, another point!
Oh, my God!
They actually made a real version of the car from Knight Rider in China, and they sold it. It was called the Yusha, and the operating system was called...
Kit.
Yes, name of Hasselhoff's car, and it featured all the sort of LEDs mimicking the ones from the show. Who doesn't want one of those?
The thing about Kit was, though, he was really sassy, so yeah. He would always tell Michael that he was wrong.
Oh, but I'd really like that. If there was, like, a sat-nav that spoke back to you, I think that would be rather good fun.
If what if it said, do you want to go to Sainsbury's, are you sure?
Surely Waitrose is more your style. I'd quite like it, I think, being the voice of sat-nav. Sass-nav.
You can record your own.
Can you?
Yeah. I had a tom-tom, I did it on that.
How long does that take? Do you have to record every road ever?
No.
He's been doing it for 9 years. This week, he's been doing Lithuanian villages.
Where's Alan in the shed, like, oh, God, Grove Avenue, Grove Street, Grove Road?
It's, you know, you just go, turn left. But because it's you, you can go, turn left! Left now!
So wait, have you just done turn left in lots of different moods?
You can, I've done all the different things in different moods, yeah.
But can you do, mind that bus? Can you
do that? That lab doesn't tell you to mind that bus.
I know that is the children, right?
I like, you have reached your destination and you haven't. I'd rather it just said, I think it's here somewhere.
Yours a bit non-committal, like, yeah, we could.
Yeah, yeah. It's round here. Have a look. Get out and look, why don't you? Buy a map. Buy a map.
Anyway, moving on. What's the lowest camping experience you can think of?
Oh, my God.
Oh, I was there that year.
Where is that, Doug?
That's Glastonbury. 2006 or 7. That was the year when there were police divers going into the tents looking for bodies.
Oh.
But I didn't find any, so it's all right.
It looks like a cross between camping and a soup from Wagamama's.
I went to Glastonbury once.
Yeah.
And I got absolutely paralytic. I woke up on the floor. Someone must have trodden on me because I had two footprints. And someone had stubbed a fag out on my face.
No!
Can I be if I'm lying on the
floor? I'm talking about the lowest campsite in the world. It is 1.6 kilometres down inside the deepest cave on Earth. Oh. It's in Georgia, the Krubera Cave. Oh. It is obviously not open to your average camper.
Ah.
This is a genuine picture from the inside of the cave. It is 13 kilometres long, it is over 2 kilometres deep, and it can fill with water really fast with absolutely no warning whatsoever. Nevertheless, people go camping down inside this cave. So, in 2018, 56 cavers from 7 different countries spent 4 weeks down inside. They were sleeping 6 to a tent, and for fun, they would dive down into sumps, which are sort of freezing... they're freezing cold passages submerged underwater, and squeeze as far as they could down these extremely narrow passageways. 4 weeks, can you imagine?
How much is it for a family of four?
It's not for me.
What do you mean it's not for you? You're a perfect size for underground living. I can't get in that corridor. Where's Sandy? Sandy! Get down there, will you? Tell if there's any sumps.
You're like Stuart Little. We get you a little car. Go and find the interesting things underground, Sandy. And make sure you come back and we'll have a lovely bit of cheese for you.
So I was listening to that flight of fancy and you went cheese and I thought, oh, I would come back for cheese. Yeah. The deepest point of the cave is called the terminal sump.
Oh, dear.
And nobody knows how deep it is.
I've got one of those. Only my doctor knows where it is.
Well, I know a Ukrainian diver who could go and have a look. There's a man called Gennady Samokin, and he holds the record for the deepest dive so far, 52 metres down to the terminal sump. Why would you do that?
I do not want to go any further down here. Sandy, Sandy, go further. Where is Sandy in her tiny car?
The thing I love about this cave is the deepest terrestrial animal ever found on Earth lives there. It's a hexapod, 3 millimetres long, just a tiny little thing. Ah. It's called a Plutomorus autobalagnensis, and it lives at nearly 2,000 metres down. Do you not think that's astonishing that life is carrying on? This is not camping, it's living there full time.
I like the element. Aw, are you looking at the same picture? I didn't really think,
You think it looks ugly, Alice, but you wait till you've seen Sandy doing dressage on one.
Those long
trot on spiky.
They're too heavy for it.
It does look like it's weighed down.
Why
by
have
itself.
I got these? These are too heavy.
They put them back.
Yes. Just needs a bit of product.
Or a scrunchie.
Yes. Camping is a pastime. First documented. Where do we reckon?
Early Victorian.
Early Victorians. It's British, so
is it?
Yeah, it is. The Victorians absolutely loved it. There was a great boating craze, so it was up and down the Thames, and some boats even converted into floating tents. The person we have to blame is a British tailor called Thomas Hiram Holding. He is regarded as the sort of father of lightweight camping. As a boy in 1853, he and his family went across the United States by a pioneer wagon across the prairies, and he absolutely loved it and has inflicted on the rest of us for the all eternity that we have
somebody
to go
camping. Somebody that wears a pussy bow is not genuinely camping.
No.
Like, I feel like he's got an inflatable mattress in there, he's got heaters, he's got hot water bottles.
Well,
a little mate, so yeah.
He rather hilariously produced the Camper's Handbook, and under meals suggestions, he provides recipes for blancmange and lobster salad.
Oh, just come out.
I can remember getting a vegetarian cookbook in the 80s and had a crisp sandwich in it.
It's not much of a tent, is it?
But he has rowed there on dry land, which is quite impressive. So.
Tide's out. You say that's not much of a tent. He sold it to Eeyore just after this photograph was taken.
Camping these days can get seriously intense. Come on.
And good night.
OK, moving on. From the deepest quest on Earth to the highest, what do Everest summiters come down with?
I was offered the chance to walk to base camp.
Right.
And I did one day's training on Hampstead Heath and declined.
They say Hampstead Heath's harder. Yeah. So you can do Hampstead.
You have to talk to the dog
walkers.
All the
dog walkers. Oh.
But there's only a fortnight in May and a fortnight in October when you can even go to the top. And the rest of the year, it's 400 mile an hour winds and minus 60.
Oh,
why would anyone go up there? You're obviously
I thought you were
going to
say it's all school groups. No, inundated.
If you do get permission to go, you have to queue. And people get really bad tempered. There are many fights that break out as people are waiting. What do they come down with?
A yeti.
A black eye, by the sounds of it, if everyone's like...
Or a fridge magnet, something like that.
One of those pens with something that slides.
Yeah.
A climber.
Well, he's a Sherpa in a bra.
He's down again. Sir Edmund. Wow. You can see his Hillary.
So the Tibetans don't call it Everest, they call it Chumalonga. And they employ, in fact, 30 porters. Their sole job is to carry poo down the mountain. Yes, to special pits further down the mountain.
You're not allowed to leave your poo up there.
Well, no. In fact, if you do climb up now, the Nepalese government, they require you to bring down 18 pounds of rubbish. That includes other people's poo, or you will lose your $4,000 deposit. Just over 26,000 pounds of human excrement is dumped at base camp.
Will the poo ever overtake...
We can do this! For comic relief.
The Nepalese porters who carry it all down, they are astonishing. They use something called a numlo. It's a sling that goes across the forehead. And on average, the male porters can carry 90% of their body mass. And there's female porters as well. They can carry 66%. There's one porter who can carry twice his own body weight. Hillary went back to the Himalayas lots of times after climbing Everest. He led an expedition. He led an expedition to look for the abominable snowman. He concluded that it didn't exist.
No?
No. But the Nepalese government has yeti hunting rules. You have to pay for a permit, is the first thing. You have to photograph or capture it, you're not allowed to kill it, and you have to turn it over or turn over the photographs of any sightings whatsoever.
I like the idea that Edmund Hillary's there at the press conference and this is what we're looking for, and there's a bunch of Sherpas in front of him. They go, oh, you mean Keith?
He said, and you see, no hat. You can tell. The yeti.
Or the centre parting. Do you think they saw lots of ones with little side parties? Like, that's not the one I'm looking for. I want the one with the curtain.
If we cannot find the yeti, we will settle for the lead singer of Herman's Hermits.
From mountains to cliffs, how did the first ever cliffhanger ending conclude?
With somebody falling off a cliff? Or somebody not falling off a cliff?
Where do we think it comes from, the idea of using a cliffhanger in a story?
Well, from serial storytelling. Was it Dickens?
This is a famous British author who first came up with this. Tess the Debevilles, Obscure...
Thomas Hardy,
Thomas Hardy. Thomas Hardy wrote a novel in 1873 called A Pair of Blue Eyes, and one of the characters, Henry Knight, is left dangling perilously off the edge of a cliff, and his love interest, Elfrida, she realises that he's in some terrible trouble, and this is rather shocking and daring at the time. She goes and takes off all her underwear in a bush and makes it into a rope and saves his life.
Makes her bush into a rope.
Is it Tess the D'Urbervilles? There's a wonderful line in this. It's dark and she's walking along and she suddenly felt a huge erection in her front and it turns out to be Stonehenge.
Wow.
The metaphorical cliffhanger, so used as a literary device, is much, much older. So the Arabian 1001 Nights is in the story from the 8th century of Sherazade, and she tells a story every night to avoid being killed, and she always ends it so that the king wants to find out what happens next.
Isn't there one in the Bible?
What is the story in the Bible?
The cliffhanger with Mary, when she tells Joseph that he's not the father of the kid, and it's like... dun, 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 dun.
What?
Yes. He's not my son?
No.
No, dun, 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 dun. That's a cliffhanger, that, isn't it?
Yeah, but I like the dun, dun. That's what I think.
You're so right. It is better with
it. It is much better.
Previously in the Bible.
Phil, you mentioned cereals. What did you mean,
cereals? Cocoa Pops. What
is it? In newspapers and
OK, but it also... there were cereal films in the early 20th century that would be shown once a week, usually on a Saturday morning, and then they would continue on from the last. And episodes tended to have some kind of suspenseful scene that would then resolve the following week. The most successful of these, probably 1914's The Perils of Pauline. That does have a literal cliffhanger in it in episode 6, with Pauline, the protagonist, clinging halfway down a cliff. But there's an effect called the Zeigarnik effect, and cliffhangers take advantage of this. People can remember uncompleted or interrupted tasks better than they can remember completed ones. So there was a psychologist working in 1927, Bluma Zeigarnik. She was the very first Russian woman ever to attend university, and she studied this phenomenon after her professor noticed that a waiter had better recollections of unpaid orders than paid ones. And she found that people will remember an interrupted task about 90% better than something that is uninterrupted. In a cliffhanger context, you remember the story better and you're more invested in it if the scene is left unresolved. Now, how did Britain's greatest national treasure get here?
Taxi.
What do you reckon? What's Britain's greatest national treasure?
Crown jewels.
It is to do with the crown jewels, the Cullinan diamond. World's largest diamond ever found.
Cool. Christ.
Like a molar.
A fox mint.
It's about the size of an orange. So if you imagine the average diamond is about the size of a seed, and you compare that to the Cullinan diamond, it was absolutely massive. It was discovered in 1905 in the Cullinan mines in South Africa. Probably the most valuable object in the world at the time. Now, as you said, is in the crown jewels. And so, obviously, they want to get it to London.
But did they just summon up to pocket it?
Well, what they did was they wanted to make sure that it was safe, so they rather ceremoniously put it in a package and they locked it inside the safe of a steamboat, and there was a team of detectives and all those things making sure this huge thing was absolutely safe. In fact, that package was a decoy, and the diamond arrived in London safe and sound by registered post. Don't you love that? They just thought, well, stick a stamp on it, be all right.
I'm very glad that you said that, because I just imagined the poor man walking all the way down the mall, going... I've got a delivery for the Queen!
Well, it was taken immediately to King Edward VII to inspect. In fact, the diamond went unsold for 2 years, and the government of Transvaal, eventually, they bought it for the equivalent of £15 million today, and they wanted to give it as a gift to the king, but the government wasn't sure. But Churchill was the colonial secretary, and he said, absolutely, we need to take this. And because everybody was so grateful in Transvaal to him for doing this, Churchill was given a replica. He used to put it on a silver plate and show it off at dinners to guests.
I like the idea that you'd take it to the king and the king would inspect it, but, I mean, I'm presuming he doesn't know loads about diamonds. I mean, what's he looking for?
I don't know.
I would have taken it to David Dickinson. he knows a bit more, doesn't he?
Well, that H.S. Samuel. Is that good?
Of course, you did have to find somebody who was good with diamonds, and the people who really knew about it was the Asher brothers in Amsterdam. Then again, they made a big song and dance out of it. The Royal Navy took a box across the North Sea. In fact, Abraham Asher took the diamond, put it in his pocket, and caught the train and went by train and ferry all the way.
Tickets, please.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
His brother, Joseph, studied the diamond and he planned the cut for weeks and weeks and weeks. 4 days before making the initial groove, he did a thing with the cutting knife and the knife broke rather than the diamond. I mean, it really was a massive thing. He spent 9 months cutting it into 9 major diamonds and 96, what they call brilliant.
What do you want it to say? Yeah. How do you spell it?
So, Cullinan's One, which is the great star of Africa, that is at the top of the scepter. And Cullinan's 2 is in front of the Imperial State Crown. They're the major components. That ruby there is Black Prince's ruby, the largest one in the world. Not cut properly, just given a bit of a polish. Now, on to the quest for true love. Who would be interested in this dating profile? Stocky build, short, bald, Bolivian male, moderate drinker, never been in a previous relationship, definitely wants children.
That's basically me.
Is it a human?
No, obviously it's not a human.
All Bolivian creature beginning with a Q.
It doesn't begin with a Q.
Well, it's in the wrong series.
It is. But we are on a quest to find this creature a mate. It is a frog.
A frog.
So this is a very sweet story, OK? This is a story of Romeo. Wow. A Sewenkus frog. So he has been living in a tank in Bolivia in the Cochabamba Natural History Museum. And it was thought that Romeo was the last one in his species. So the last one in his species is called an endling. And in 2018, his conservationist set up an online dating profile for him on Match.com in an effort to find him a mate. And here is the video that they made for their search.
Hi there, I'm Romeo, a Sewenkus water frog from Bolivia. I'm a pretty simple guy. I tend to keep to myself and love spending nights at home. I also love eating. Then again, who doesn't?
Oh, who could resist, right? Who could resist?
They're good friends to do that.
Didn't want to do it himself.
Yeah.
It's embarrassing.
It's embarrassing.
To do it
they're good mates.
Get
they're
your friends to do it.
Miguel, could you do a video for me?
Hey, why don't I put it you? Get catchy the worm.
You
come out under the rock. You get the worm.
I have the tiny arms of the frog. It is not possible for me to hold the phone.
in the world.
Say what you want me to say.
Write it down on a big biz of pepper behind your phone.
The thing is, it worked.
Loads of frogs started turning up.
Who toad in a frog bra?
Hello.
They went out on a frog-finding expedition. They found 3 males and 2 females, and he has now been paired with a female who they have obviously named...
Juliet.
Exactly right.
See, because I am called Romeo. This photograph was taken of me at my modern jazz dance class. When you dance in Bolivia, you must never smile.
About Romeo's personality, because they put him with Juliet, and she's really energetic. She loves to swim, she eats a lot, she keeps trying to escape, and
she is driving me on the wall. She's climbing out of the tank.
Yeah.
He's very... eating my worms.
He's very shy.
He doesn't like her. There's no such thing as shyness. How that's an affectation. Oh. He doesn't like her, and he's acting as if he's shy. I want a different one. This is...
There are other animal dating apps. There is a dating app called Tudder. Does anybody know what that might be?
For cows?
It is for cows.
Oh, my Lord.
It was launched in early 2019, and you can browse cattle from all over the UK to find a suitable mate for your livestock. You can request either cows or bulls, and you do literally swipe left or right.
Find someone that looks at you the way that Freesia is looking at me, honestly.
Apparently, Andy Murray has invested in Tudder. I don't know why.
That's not true, is it?
Yeah, that is a true thing, yes.
Why?
I don't know the... I don't know the workings of his mind.
I don't know if you're aware, but I recently had an artificial hip put in. So I need to find new avenues of revenue. And I thought cow dating. I was on a lot of painkillers.
That sound anything like him at all.
Yeah, but I sound a lot like the Bolero.
It's like the frog was in the room. But I don't know who this bloke is.
I'm Andy Murray. I won Wimbledon.
He certainly physically resembled him.
How are the cows swiping left or right with the
I think they get the farmers to do that. Speaking of breeding, who has the world's most sinister genitals?
In attendance or in the world?
In the world, the most sinister genitals.
Sinister as in to the left.
Exactly. Yes. Oh, how we play.
Oh, is that what that means?
It's a Latin for left. So, in 2017, there was a snail called Jeremy, who was really lonely.
And oh, there is.
Yeah, so...
Where's he from? I'll do the accent.
Jeremy was from southwest London.
What?
What? This is an extremely rare sinistral snail. So that means that the shell spirals to the left. So he was called Jeremy because they named him after Jeremy Corbyn. But it meant his genitals were on the wrong side. So he could only have sex with another snail who also had genitals on the left side. Anyway, they did a search and they found 2 potential mates. This is a lovely story.
You keep saying it's a lovely story. A succession of perverts trying to get weird animals to have sex. This isn't a lovely story at all.
Wait.
I want to see the snails.
I've never seen a snail.
With his old fella on the left hand side. Snail porn, come on. It takes ages.
This is a nice story because 2 potential mates were found. 1 in Spain and 1 in Suffolk. And they brought the 3 together.
Oh, now it's a threesome.
No. No, it's worse, darling. The ones from Spain and Suffolk got down to it and Jeremy had to watch.
Was he videoing it? This is the key.
Yeah. You say he had to watch. He could have just gone indoors.
Yeah.
Now, because I love you, Phil, we do actually have some snail porn.
Oh, yeah.
There's a snails engaging in foreplay. So what they do is they circle and they touch each other's tentacles. If you look carefully there, you can see their penises come out of their heads. That is just a thing. It's a snail thing.
Oh, baby.
Yeah.
Don't worry about unblocking the sink. Come to bed.
Now, only one final challenge remains for our gallant knights as we trepidate into the treacherous kingdom of general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Which is the closest planet to Earth?
Mars.
Not Mars. Anybody else?
Venus.
Oh, yeah.
The moon?
No, just... generally.
Mercury.
Yes, absolutely right. It is Mercury. But it's not how we normally think of it. So the minimum distance between the Earth and Venus is 24 million miles. If you have a look at this, this is how we generally
think... very, very near, isn't it?
..of it. Yeah, well, it is in sort of space terms. The minimum distance to Mars is 34 million miles and to Mercury it's 48 million miles. So you would imagine that it all goes like that and everybody stays in the same lineup. However, that is not how orbits work. So let's have a look at this video, which explains it a little bit more. Initially, it looks as though Mercury is the furthest away, but the way the orbits function is that Venus often is right the other side of the Sun, making it really, really far away. And there's a guy called Oliver Hawkins, and he wrote some computer code to try and work this out. And he found that the planet that spends most of the time closer to Earth than any other is Mercury. So it's closest to Earth 46% of the time. Venus was closest 36% of the time, and Mars only 18%
of the time. I think I did say all of that.
Yeah. Venus is an astonishing place because a day on Venus is longer than a year. It rotates so slowly that you could stroll across its surface at exactly the same speed as the Sun passes through the sky. It means you could watch the sunset forever just by walking.
But you'd be eviscerated.
You would, darling. It rains, it rains sulfuric acid and the atmosphere is 872 degrees Fahrenheit.
But anything for a sunset, am I right?
Yeah. Anybody have a mnemonic to remember the planets in order?
Yes. It's Mercury, yep. Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune.
Thank you, darling, that's perfect. That is the order and...
Pluto doesn't count. It's actually a Disney character.
Yes, that's right. That is the order of the planets, and one is often taught it at school. So many volcanoes emit mulberry jam sandwiches under normal pressure. Or my very easy method just speeds up naming planets, so there were...
I couldn't get past vagina, though. I've got moist vagina expected, might just steam up 90.
So weirdly, that's probably the one I'm going to remember. Anybody else? Alice, you've got one?
Mine's quite depressing.
Okay.
Mum's vacant expression means Jane sulks unless noticed.
Wow, you were a jolly girl at school. My favourite is Mary's virgin explanation made Joseph suspect upstairs neighbour. Worth pointing out, of course, that Pluto is no longer regarded as a planet.
No, not there.
It's now a dwarf. But on the subject of Earth, where would you find the oldest part of it?
Antique shop.
Alice is sort of heading in the right direction in terms of it being on display somewhere.
Is it a fossil in a museum? Is it something like that?
Well, it's actually in Houston.
Oh, it's the moon rock. Moon rock?
It is, darling. It is absolutely a piece of moon rock.
Because it was...
Don't blind me with science. What's that?
So we're talking about Apollo 14, so 1971. They brought some bits and pieces back and they haven't really had time to analyse them all. You know how you have stuff in a box and you think, oh, I must get to it. So it's at NASA's Lunar Sample Laboratory facility in Houston. And in January 2019, they analysed a piece of this rock and they realised it came from what's known as the Hadean Earth. So we are talking about the planet only being about 500 million years old at that point. And it was found on the moon, but almost certainly what happened is this particular specimen was blasted off the Earth about 4 billion years ago when a large asteroid struck. So it would have shot through what would have been much thinner atmosphere and collided with the moon, which at that time was only a third of its current distance. As I'm sure you know, the moon is drifting away from the Earth annually about 1.6 inches. used to be much closer than it is. So that is an astonishing thing that they found it in a cupboard. It's only tiny, it's a chip, just about a couple of centimetres squared.
Everyone's got that drawer with, you know,
yes,
elastic bands,
yep,
like a USB
Euros,
some floppy disks.
We cleared out our understairs cupboard and we found three fondue sets. What is...
I've never been less surprised by anything before.
The oldest known piece of earth was found on the moon. What is the name of this sword?
Excalibur.
It isn't.
Yeah.
Not this.
Right. That's the first one he got. Excalibur's the one later.
Yes.
From the Lady of the Lake. The one he pulled out the stone is called Terry.
Oh.
Yeah, you're right there.
Terry the sword.
The sword and stone's likely called Clarent.
Clarent?
Clarent, and it's a sword of peace.
He pulled it out of the stone shortly before buying his first pair of trousers.
Quite a fit, aren't they?
That's what they're all laughing at. Yeah. I did see a boy in the street the other day wearing jeggings. A boy.
It's a mistake, isn't it?
Jeggings. I know. You can see everything. Could
I
you
know.
See he was sinister? I know a snail like it.
And we end with the quest for eternal life. So, Sir Alan of Carr, your final challenge.
Okay.
Upon yonder table lies the chalice of eternal life. Prithee, select the one true holy grail and bring it to me.
Oh, OK.
Yeah, good luck.
Is this my hat?
Oh, yes, of course.
If I'm into, like, Indiana Jones, I look like a Charlie Hungerford from Bergerac. Do you know what I mean?
Right, so you are looking for the Holy Grail. Which one are you going to select?
What's that Indiana Jones one where he thinks that Jesus' cup will be like the golden one, but it's the modest one, isn't it?
OK. So what do you reckon?
Well, I think it's the wooden one.
Here is the thing, you should have picked the tray. Tray is the Holy Grail. A grail was most likely a serving dish, so would you please bring me the tray? And none of the cups whatsoever.
Has it got one of those beanbag padded bottoms?
I love those.
If I could have that, please, darling. The word grail...
Like...
Thank you, sweetheart. It comes from the Latin gradale, grail, and it means a deep platter that you would serve food on during medieval banquets. It gradually evolved from sort of Middle Ages onwards into people thinking it was a larger vessel with an elaborate cover and then a drinking cup. Traditionally, the idea is it gives immortality to the drinker, although the Bible gives no special significance to the chalice that Jesus uses to consecrate his blood wine. It became very popular in Arthurian tales. One of these stories tells of Joseph of Arimathea bringing it to Glastonbury, actually, where he
got buried... smashed. Oh my God!
Well, there's a stream that runs red. Is that right?
Oh, by the Red Bull stand.
Well, the legend has it it's because it's travelled through Christ's blood via the Holy Grail. I think spoil sports scientists will tell you it's the high levels of iron red oxide in the soil. Well, I'm afraid you picked wrong, but you look very fetching in the hat. I would love to see a camp Indiana Jones. Something terrible happens, he goes, woo! a grail actually looks like this, which means a holy grail looks like this.
No!
I'm working my arse off here, people. Which brings us to the scores. In first place, with minus one, it's Phil! Second place with minus seven, making a fantastic debut, it's Alan Carr. In third place, a surprising minus 15, Alan. Oh. And in last place with minus 18, it's Alice. Farewell to my noble knights, Alice, Alan, Phil, and Alan and me. Till we meet again, let us dwell upon this questing quotation from the late great knight of the realm, Sir Terry Pratchett. So much universe and so little time. Good night.